Hello everyone! Today we examine the idea of visualization as data inputs and unpack some of the potential as well as some of the weirdness that appear when you invert traditional model of visualization and introduce visual designs that produce dataset and not the other way around. This is a collaboration between me, Samuel Herand, from Institut Polytechnique de Paris,
and me, Wesley Willett, from the University of Calgary. Specifically, we'd like to draw the community's attention to this under-considered class of visualization designs that we've been calling input visualizations. These are visual representations that are designed to collect new data rather than encode pre-existing datasets. That said, even the term input visualization is really just a first stab, and we'd love to discuss if you have more thoughts on a precise name for these designs.
To help unpack this idea, we will start by highlighting four existing examples of input visualization, then introduce a series of provocations that we hope will get you thinking about some contradictions they pose. One of the examples that prompted our first discussion about input visualization was the New York Times, The Death of a Terrorist, A Turning Point, published in 2011, just after the killing of Osama bin Laden. This interactive let viewers indicate their feeling about that event by marking a point in a two-dimensional scatter plot with significant and insignificant and positive and negative axes, and then adding a comment. Over a few days, this inputs creating a visualization of reader overall sentiment.
Similarly, the visual backchannel tool Polemic Tweet used visualizations to engage users in an evolving discussion around conference presentations. Polemic Tweet included a Twitter client that invited viewers to tweet using a specific grammar, including plus plus for agreement or two question marks for questions, and then visualize these tags alongside the discussion. Input visualizations are also quite common in participatory visualization work. For example, Colombian designer José Duarte's Preguntas sobre el Barrio, or Questions about the Neighborhood, includes a variety of physical chart templates in which passersby can indicate their feelings about issues such as transportation, security, and urban planning using physical tokens like stickers or balls. These kinds of visual voting systems are perhaps the most straightforward examples of the input visualization paradigm, with individuals literally adding or changing visual marks to add new information.
Pauline Gourlet and Thierry Dassé-Cain represent an even more elaborate version of this approach, using a tangible tabletop to enable data collection and sharing in a community makerspace. Cain used a much more complex visual encoding schema, with conversable physical tokens that let makers to record the both quantitative and qualitative information about their project. This example, along with a bunch of other ones, which we note in the paper, hint at the diversity of input visualization as well as the general haziness about what qualify as one.
They've probably also already started to raise some questions in your mind about input visualizations as an approach. And we want to raise a few specific provocations to help drive a bigger discussion about them. First, you might be thinking, input visualizations aren't new. Humans have designed artifacts that encode information into visual structures for millennia, and tally marks on bones, voting by dropping a ball in an urn, and many other historical examples are arguably input visualizations according to our definition. So are lots of everyday tools like physical and digital calendars.
On the other hand, if you want to push back, you might argue that while this example may look like visualization, they are not. After all, most of these input visualizations don't align neatly with garden variety description of visualization, which usually explain visualization approach as visually encoding data to make it easier to understand. Here, the Viz literature is a bit more mixed, with some classical definitions like Card, McKinley, and Schneiderman's providing enough wiggle room to include input visualization, while others, like Kame and Halls, emphasize the communication of abstract data in ways that would seem to exclude them.
Input visualizations also butt up against the kind of visualization rhetoric that paints raw data as inherently truthful. There's still a persistent concern about lying with data in the Viz community, and this regularly leads to outcry over tools that, for example, allow users to directly manipulate points in graphs or alter underlying data tables. But this disdain ignores a whole bunch of common and well-justified reasons for modifying data values, including organizing content or tuning predictions. After all, data wrangling almost always involves changing the data. On the other hand, inputting data into an existing visualization has some interesting and potentially problematic implications for data quality. Most credible polls don't show results prior to soliciting a response, and doing so might influence how individuals add new values or even encourage attempts to pollute the data. Building a better understanding of how input visualizations might bias data entry is definitely a promising area for future research. Finally, input visualizations might cause us to ask, when do we consider data to be data? While some examples of input visualizations produce structured and easily interpretable data tables, many manifest data only in the visual artifact itself and in ways that can make that data hard to quantify or reproduce. For example, how should we interpret a mark in a physical voting system that intersects both yes and no? What information, if any, does an elaborate stack of tokens communicate if the semantics of ordering aren't specified in the instructions?
Input visualization also collide with deeper epistemological discussion about the nature of data itself. Already, researchers like Johanna Drucker and Bruno Latour have criticized the implication of the term data, whose Latin epistemology, given, implies objectivity. Drucker advocates instead that all data is in fact capta, which is actively taken, and therefore subject to a whole slew of human biases. And if we go further down the epistemological rabbit hole, we can even find a pre-digital definition of data, like the one of Diderot and D'Alembert 18th century encyclopedia, that further differentiate data, which are given, from quasi-data, which are unknown and which one seeks. Given this perspective, you could argue that the information captured in an input visualization are only data or capta after they have been entered. Up until that point, including when the visualization is being designed, this future piece of information remain quasi-data, which are sought but not yet obtained. With that in mind, maybe we shouldn't be discussing input visualization at all, but rather capta visualization or even quasi-data visualization.
As it stands, input visualizations remain a niche and unconsidered corner of the viz universe, but one that we suspect is full of research opportunities, including developing new conceptual models that better accommodate these approaches, more systematically examining the design space of input visualizations, and exploring new tools for creating them. With this in mind, we encourage the community to further examine this space. We're really excited to hear any ideas, examples, or responses you have to the idea of visualizations as data input.